Hello, everybody, and welcome to City States of Clarissa, The God War, featuring three members of the raid team. We had a family emergency from one of our players, and another player is in Vegas right now, getting scammed.
Also
No.
I'm back!
Whenever Shen shows up, he can rejoin us, but for now, Shen is off the raid team. Absentee, all that stuff. How are you three doing today?
I'm good.
Doing good, Bob. Doing good.
You're good. You sick of me yet, John?
Yes.
We've had a lot of time together this weekend.
Oh, what is that?
Who we got?
Harry Potter.
No.
Leonard. It's glaring. I can't see the last name. There we go. Hofstadter. Who is he?
Leopold Hofstadter. That's Big Bang Theory.
Yeah.
Leonard.
Bran wins.
The one that marries Penny.
Yes.
He was Sheldon's roommate.
The shortest.
Is this some television peasant humor
it's
that
a TV
I don't
show
understand?
Called Big Bang Theory. It was kind of a big deal. It was on for 12 seasons.
I don't own
John.
A TV and never have,
and
so fuck
it
off.
Shows.
Yeah,
it shows.
Someone has to not watch television. I guess it might have been me.
And the commies.
Anyway. I guess I got right there.
Got him.
As always, the person who wasn't here last has to do the recap. So please, Mr. Brandon, take us away.
Well, number three made a deal with some wizard dude in Narnia. Number four. went through a portal to Narnia to make a deal with some kind of wizard.
Mm-hmm.
And then they all got snake tattoos on their face, like in Hangover.
Yep.
Let's see. Number two's pilot decided to go on a little joyride while we were there, and now number two wants to kill him. But Big Boss said no, so we'll see how that goes. And I think if I recall right, I think I got sent back, or I'm over in Telst right now.
Yeah, you actually got the long rest out of the team.
Yes.
Or started one, or... No, okay, now I remember where we left off. We had just gone out for a week, scouting out your new terrain and finally deciding on your colony's position. That's what we did in the end of last week.
Thought there was more.
Was there missionary?
What?
Well, you said position, so I wasn't sure if we were doing
you
missionary.
You are such a shit. Why are you... I missed you, Brian, but god damn it.
Oh, man. That one
Brandon's always... Okay, JC, I don't know if you intentionally always misspell everyone's name or if I'm bad at speaking, but he's never been called Brendan. He's Brandon. What is happening?
Oh. It's an O-N, sir. O-N.
Okay, so John,
that's how you know I'm always
to...
on.
Oh my god, this is the week where the political team had a boat battle with a mad artificer. Capital M in mad, too. Oof.
Like crazy or angry? Or
it
both?
Is... the 21st. You guys have returned to Telst after submitting your paperwork and applications, Brondon, to get your colony started. Your city's colony started, which you guys will be privately investing in to make bank. So, it is the 21st of March, also known as spring shifting. We have perpetual downtime, I suppose. It's up to you guys what you want to do.
I need to have a few more scrolls made.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you gonna make them?
poor favor. Yes.
If we're in Tulse, Chad wants to hit up the Brotherhood of the Fist and try and get a few of them to come back with us on the airship to help provide defense to the town when we are not around.
The colony has not even begun setting up yet. You have picked its location.
Drum up the interest.
Okay. I was going to say, that's actually pretty smart to set up a pre-contract for when it does happen, so that way we don't have to deal with rushing that later on. That's called foresight.
That's why I've been getting them really fucking drunk every time I go back. I need my gang on my side.
When did Chad's monk get a plus 20 fucking intellect?
He's been hanging out with Igor too much.
Apparently. True.
And then still also wants to work with Crumpet and work out the kinks of the gnome holster.
We are no longer doing the gnome holster. It's really boring. I'm sorry. It's really dumb. If you're just gonna take away half of his turn, we can just skip him moving around all right then and there, right?
Can I get? I want a refund on my holsters.
I
don't
cannot.
Remember how much they were.
No. There is no refund. All purchases are final. So you want to make scrolls? Ebor, is there anything you want to do before we get into the Dungeon Master's Guide for Scroll Making?
I'd attempt to learn some more spells.
Okay. I guess the real question is, how long do we want to do downtime? Because Lei Shung's timer is a ticking. There is a day on my calendar where Lei Shung dies. I'm not telling you when that is. You guys have a rough estimate. But you know.
Did we get in a long rest in the last episode? I think we did, right? So no one's.
I don't think you needed one. I think only Syl needed a long rest. That's why you sent him back.
So he got the long rest, right?
Syl has the long rest, yes. So he has all of his spells back.
I'm slightly less concerned about hanging around.
I thought Igor needed one too, because he's completely out of his charges.
He has the new Tasha's sacrifice your thing every day to get. Oh my god, Nick.
Get him.
Bam!
Bam, 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 bam.
Lei Shung dies today. Holy shit, Apollo. Apollo's for killing CK this session, so if we go 6 weeks, boys.
Fucking Babe Ruth calling his shot. Ouch.
Yes. So how long do we want to do stuff?
Well,
we could do this in an afternoon, right? How long does scroll making take?
Like a day per level or something.
Good thing we got a whole bunch of simulacrums to help us out, am I right?
Not if Syl is making spells off his spell list. There'll also be a small arcana check with them as well, Bran.
Say again.
There will be an arcana check when you do it. Make a spell scroll.
Is this something he could have been doing during his long rest period as well?
No. It is a highly magically intensive process where you are putting your soul onto paper so that you can later resummon it.
Oh, I was going to have someone do it for me.
What spell scrolls are you trying to get?
I have -1 in Arcana. Like, I pay people to do this. I make peasants do this for me.
Okay. Well, yeah. Depends on what spells you want, then.
It's just,
is it like, you can't cast Featherfall, right? So.
It's just a Revivify.
So you need to find a 5th level character that has Revivify? I don't know if anyone would have that, because Ozark is not a cleric. Or a druid, or... Ozark is notoriously a wizard. Wow. Alright. Syl, give me an investigation check. On your long rest, you were trying to find someone in the reserves who is a level 5 person who has Revivify. And you do not find them.
Like the one time I roll somewhat decent.
Yep. I just rolled a DC. I'm sorry.
Alright, I guess I'll try to make it myself and do an Arcana check?
Okay. I don't think it has to be Intelligence Arcana, but that is still a 7. So, let me look at how to make a spell scroll. Yeah, I mean, that's a failure no matter what, but...
Yeah, but I mean, if I can use, like, if it's based off of my,
like... Yeah, it would be based off your spell casting modifier, so it would be a Charisma Arcana check.
I don't even know how that would work. Do I just roll a saving throw?
It looks like it would just be a regular Charisma check for you, since you were not proficient in Arcana.
So... Do I just click Charisma?
You would have just clicked Charisma, but we're taking that 5. Or 7, excuse me.
Fuck!
Spells on your spell list. You can read the scroll and cast a spell. Wizard spell on a spell scroll can be copied. Once copied, blah blah blah.
I mean, if it uses his Shaw, 7 plus 5 is 12? Is 12 good, boss?
DC equals 10. It'd have to be a 13. Because the flat DC is 10 plus the spell's level. So Revivify's a third level spell. So the DC would be... It's not actually that hard to make a scroll. It's just...
Apparently it is. Because I rolled a fucking 18 on my
Still, you're constantly like... drunk. You're like, Ozark, make me a Revivify scroll. And of course, he's just like, go to bed. You're tired. Go take your long rest. And drunkenly, you try to just hammer out this scroll during that week. And it does not go at all what you expected.
We'll try again next week.
Next week, yeah. Ibor, what spell did you want to learn?
I was thinking water breathing would be a really good one, but it's third level, so it might take a little bit of time.
It would be 1d2 per spell level, so at most it's going to take 6 days. Is that something you want to do?
I mean, if the rest of the party is okay with 6 days, potentially...
Well, there's only two of you making executive decisions, so...
Like,
if I'm going to play the Leishtun card here, he's got, what, 4 weeks? Sounds right? 5 weeks, maybe? Somewhere in the we've at least spent a week last episode time frame. Sound right?
Yeah. It's 21st when we start our week today.
Leishtun would vote go find Grimir and bring it to Gimamonth, or whatever that thing's name was.
Yeah. So do we just want to get back in the airship immediately and set sail for Destry?
Yeah.
The notoriously landlocked country.
Isn't that where all the kids are there? The kid soldiers of Destry?
Cool. Yeah.
We've managed to avoid that thus far.
Wow.
I'm excited. I can use my sickening radiance on children.
I mean, if you have that harness, you can probably throw one of them in the back.
Oh shit, that'd be funny as fuck.
Imagine a kid with a fucking slingshot.
Yeah.
Like, that sounds right up Sill's alley.
A toddler with a Glock is just in your carrier. Just bang, bang, bang!
I like it.
Tell me what you guys want to do, and we will start doing that.
I thought we were going to Destry. Oh! Or we could do a shopping episode.
Oh shit, girl, I'm in, says Chad. But we have to do this right. Can't we go shopping in Destry whilst trying to find Grimir? Eh? Por que no los dos?
But Especially since there's only three of us.
Like, I looked at our details for this. It says, bring Grimir to Iamamon within 6 weeks, or Lysjong will die, Pog. That's exactly the details that we have to go off of, and it wasn't my character, so I wasn't paying the closest attention. What about you, Ivor? Photographic memory, perhaps?
No.
Okay. good talk, team. Hands in. Ready? And let's go see Lysjong.
I think Ivor has an issue that a lot of smart people do. They're very smart, but they don't always listen because they get bored because things aren't smart enough for them.
I must be a fucking genius.
Oh my god.
You read the contract.
Yeah, but I forgot the contract. I read it and understood it.
That's fair. Alright, so let's get the destry. Let's do some shopping. Relax and get a lay of the land. And,
yes, relaxing in an active war zone.
With a teammate with a death clock over his head.
Shopping in an active war zone.
Yeah.
You guys restock, refuel as you prepare for your shopping stream.
We have party money?
We have quite a bit.
There's some on the boat.
There's
a shit ton on the ship.
But we need to save a bunch of that for the colony too. So Ivor, what do you need? Because Chad would be willing to share on a shopping trip.
I don't know what there's going to be, but I've got 5 silver pieces to my name, so if it's a dagger, I can't buy it.
Chad says, hang on, follow me. And we head off to Chad's secret stash location, his locker, wherever it was.
You go to a jank secret storage facility with Chad, Ivor. The place where you'd hide a body.
Chad eyes up Ivor, who's a tiny little thing, and he's like, you can't carry much gold, can you?
No.
Great. So Chad will reach into storage. He's got plenty of crap stored. He'll pull out 1,000 gold pieces worth of gems and hand it to you and say, don't spend it all in one place, kid.
Ivor, you are now richer than you will ever be and have been in your entire life.
Chad will then remind Ivor that this is a
chump change.
So please return this when we get our next cut.
So, gems, 1,000 GP.
1,000 GP's worth of gems,
Hey, John, I have a question for you, and this is, meta, not, I don't think it's meta gaming, but, outside the RP, and someone ordered armor from
the City of Binding Lights.
No, it wasn't City of Binding, was it City of Binding Lights, or was it in the Crazy Clown People place?
Nope. You guys did not stick around there.
So, it was some old lady. I can't remember. Either or. Yep. But, shouldn't have that gun sent out by now?
Nope. Oh. I have it written down in my calendar. It's one of my few, I think May. Yeah. It's May 28th when it will be ready. It's currently March 21st. So.
Oh. All right, girls, let's go shopping.
That has taken money from his stored location, is loaded and ready to go on the town.
Okay.
The war-torn town.
Perfect. So, do you guys even stop in Tulst, or do you just pick up your stuff, grab Syl, and you're all right, let's go?
Oh, did I get to do my RP with my gang to drum up interest in future defense of colony?
Yeah, let's do that real quick.
We're at the bar.
Yeah, you're at your local bar. What do you say to your friends who are always, the dregs of society hanging out in any sleazy...
Normally, I drop a crazy amount of Tulst bucks and just get them drunker than I'll be. But I'm still going to drop... I got 100 Tulst bucks to my name, so I'm going to spend that funny money
Chad, you gotta tell us, man. Where are you getting all this dope?
After throwing the toll bucks, I throw another 400 GP out on the table.
Holy.
And I say, boys, this is me holding back. I have an opportunity, an investment, if you will, and I need all of you.
The 30 or so Brotherhood of the Fist are all keen to hear your proposal.
So, in all my adventures out kickflipping and ass kicking, boys, I've drummed up quite a bit of cash. I'm in the process of helping start pioneer a town. Soon, that town will be coming into existence and will need defense. I trust you boys being the ones who helped raise me through most of my youths. I trust you all more than anyone. With my life, I wish nothing more than for you to come and help me to make this town a reality.
Also, like as, like, extortioners?
To be determined. We barely even laid ground yet.
I'm not like a soldier, brother. I'm like... I'll throw a bottle in somebody's face and, like, you know, stab them with the broken bottle.
That's fine. As long as we have the same enemies, like, we're cool. And you can get filthy fucking rich in the process.
Right.
Chad points to the giant pile that he has just thrown and reminds him of every time that he's come back. And it's like, look, like, I'm going out. I'm showing the world what the Brotherhood of the Fist can do. No one can stop me. I'm fucking Chad. Does kickflip.
Yeah. You do a fucking kickflip. No problem. You kickflip the table.
To be really fucking fancy on this. Oh, it's not as showy as I wish it was, but I still fucking nailed it.
True. Like Tony Hawk mixed with a drunk anorexic biker, you have set the groundwork.
Skater boy.
For
see you later, boy.
See you later, boy.
Hey.
I guess with all of Tull stuff done? Question mark. Looks to Ybor and Syl. All right, you guys can start flying to Dustry.
Making my way downtown, walking fast.
I was going to say about, do we do XP? Because we haven't done that in a couple of weeks.
You're missing half your team. No one, only Syl would be getting XP, and since Syl does not get XP, because he's a bitch.
The elementals?
I don't get XP until y'all hit my level now, apparently.
We haven't actually rested since the elementals to get the XP from
No one has done a long rest. You guys have just been short resting to get all your mechanics back. So, I mean, if you want to burn another week and long rest, someone might hit 6 in theory, but...
I mean, technically, it's not our life that's in peril, so I don't give a fuck.
I mean, we... I'll play the Leishtung and Chad card. We want Leishtung alive.
We do want Leishtung alive.
Do we?
I think Ygor has the most out of you guys. What's level 6?
14k? Question mark.
Okay.
16?
No, I think it's 14 something.
It is 14,000. Let me do a rough estimate of your experience. What would you have gotten from just combat?
Whatever it is, divided by 3.
Because even if they level, you shouldn't, Ybor. The server
still... No, I don't think I would, but I thought maybe everyone else might.
I might. It depends on how much we got. I don't know if we got a lot.
I don't think so. Yeah, you guys, if Igor's the highest in XP, he's still like 2,000 off, just off combat, and you guys haven't even done a quest yet. I mean, I give you stuff for like town settlement, but, you know, you literally looked at a map and then picked a place to like settle.
Pedestrian it is.
Okay. You guys can head to Destry, as John did quick math.
Do we get the whole squad going with us, or do we inexplicably lose Leishtung, whose life we're going to
No, everyone's with you, for the purposes of this. Hopefully you guys don't do any combat immediately, because I don't want to share people's character sheets, I guess.
So, don't roll for initiative when you see a little
Try
child?
Not to. It's going to take you guys most of a day to get to Destry. So, let's just say you guys head out on the early morning of the 21st. By late afternoon, you guys will be in Destry proper. You fly over Thorazor, you fly over endless fields, light forests, uncivilized plains, several rivers. You get trailed after by a Thorazorian interceptor as you fly close to their airspace, but they do not engage nor make contact with your airship. They are just seeing what you're doing, realize you have no ranged weapons, and then leave you be. And you guys will soon find yourselves docking in the central kind of tower, I suppose, where another airship is currently docked at, a transport airship, which is unloading its cargo into a grand plaza. Gentlemen, welcome to Destry, the Renaissance fair of the entire world. It is currently a half-destroyed city-state that has no outer wall, for it never needed one. The town is at, let's see, less than half capacity right now. Maybe like 7,000 people are kind of spread out through a several square mile area. Yeah. It is not looking great as you guys land and get your bearings. You are in Destry. The airship needs to recharge since it traveled 900 miles. If it goes 50 miles out, or more than 50 miles out, there's no coming back to a place where it can safely recharge its sails. It's arcane batteries.
And John, real quick, because yes. The person who's going to die is not here, and I really wasn't paying the best of attention. The TLDR recap, we need to bring Grimir back through that portal, right?
Yes.
We do not want to kill Grimir and bring pieces of Grimir back. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Don't kill this thing. Got it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Syl, you had the opportunity of getting a matching snake tattoo from a shadow wizard. Would you have gotten one with your teammates, or fuck that?
Ebor didn't.
I was just gonna say no. Syl's pretty handsome. He's actually, like, maxed out in handsomeness. So, he's not gonna ruin his face.
Hang on, I think I had info about the tattoo.
It should be a...
It was a 14 sickness.
Yeah.
Pretty cool tattoo.
It was a pretty good tattoo. This, like, skeletal snake with a purple outline around it. It's gonna bite out at somebody. But if you hesitated... Okay. No, sir. You don't need it. It's fine. Excuse me.
Then all the narrative decisions stand.
Good. You guys land and disembark, loaded with cash in a land filled with dirty peasants. What would you like to do?
Is anyone selling robes?
They're selling, like, peasant tunics.
Yep, one please.
Okay, how much do you want to pay them?
Gold?
Okay, cool. They will take your one gold, give you a fine... I believe the colors here are Viridian and purple, green and purple. Greenish, purplish robes. Or not robes, a tunic. So, you know, just like a big cloth covering that you tie off at the belt.
Oh, rip.
They are not neon color, I'm sorry. Though goldenrod, medium aquamarine, and khaki-ish are a strange set of colors.
How about goldenrod and khaki?
This big plaza that you guys have sort of docked at, where this transport airship is currently also docked and being unloaded, recharging or refueling, this is where the Tulst Expeditionary Force is headquartered. You guys are part of the task force, so when people are like, yo, who are you? You guys get a quick hand wave from the people in charge. General or Field Marshal Brillian knows what the Tulse Task Force do. Knows you are an extra legal body of the Tyrant's, you know, military wing, his personal guard, if you will, who go out and clear objectives that he has no command over. So you guys can freely dock here and then properly fuck off if you so choose.
I like it.
They're here to help you, but they won't, you know, force you to stay.
Be donning my Tulse Task Force outfit during this, but I'm going to keep those Destry Tuner groups in case we need to quick get away.
Just for you, though. No one else has
obviously,
them.
Obviously, new.
What's your best peasant accent, Chad?
Please, sir, I want some more.
Thank
yes,
you.
My Continue. Lord.
I used to be an adventurer like you, so I took an arrow to the knee.
John is just looking at scene descriptors. Everyone has been in Destry by now, so I'm kind of being lax on the environmental exposition, but for those who have never heard about Destry before, it is a land of vampires. The sky is permanently overcast, always threatening rain. There are great forests that scatter the landscape, be they lightly pocketed or extremely dense. And currently they just have a shit ton of peasants running about. How many of you guys know what's happening in Destry?
Apparently a war?
Bad heard tales, I believe, through Runt in the crossover episode of what happened.
Yeah.
I know nothing.
Ybor / KJC knows nothing of Destry. And thus it is...
Yeah.
It is a strange thing for you to see people queuing up outside of a fenced-off plaza where people are your people, you know, Tulse dudes wearing military uniforms are handing out food from the airship that is docked to the city-goers. You see motorized vehicles, some which are familiar, that you guys had once, you know, driven through the snow in. Well, no. None of you have, actually. Chad wasn't there for that. Only Ygor would recognize it and be like, yo, look at that! And then Ygor would, like, look to all of you who were never there for that ride through that cave.
Sad Ygor, both of
them.
Womp womp.
Poor Devon. He's not here to realize this. This would be a really good character moment. Oh, now it's gone forever. So you see some armored cars, you see squads rolling in and rolling out, heading to who knows where, likely the countryside. You have no idea where you're going, you just know that Grimir is somewhere here. And then you also see a frog. A frog vampire, which some of you may recognize. Because Revic is here during this time.
Know if anyone's met Revic. Ygor probably would have been the only one. Or maybe Syl?
True. No. Still
no.
Haven't met.
Yeah, Revic. No one's met Revic either.
Man, so, what a weird frog guy.
Yeah.
Right? What's with the Kermit the Frog mixed with Dracula doing?
He's hanging out with Just Meza, for those who know her. Ygor knows Just Meza.
Okay,
barely.
You're just gonna have to start fresh because I'm
yeah.
talking to be
still knows nothing. No one, nobody. You know, still, I don't even think you even signed up for the task force. I think you're here just as a fresh-faced, high-leveled adventurer on your own who is indebted to Ozark. You're like an extra legal body who doesn't even like believe in what the Tyrant's even doing here.
It's fair. That's
yeah.
true.
Alright. Chad has one plan in all of this.
Shopping?
No. Well, okay. Yes, but first, Chad's gonna get a little high. Chad's gonna use the detective's pipe of insight to ponder, which at this point, we've definitely been long past the 1d6 plus one day since the last time I used it. Thinking about this situation, if I was a Grimir, where the hell would I be? Where would I go to in this town?
What do you know about Grimir?
That's a great question. Grimir's a skeleton. Grimir is, hang on, I'm pulling up the very, very limited notes that I have not taken on this.
Uh-oh. We have the non-note takers who are heading an investigation, people in chat.
Grimir, the skeleton delegate.
If he's a delegate, that shouldn't be that difficult to find.
So, Syl, how would you propose, as Chad's lighting up this pipe, that we go around finding this thing?
Well, if he's a skeleton... Cemetery?
Delegate? Cemetery's a cool place.
I mean, if he needs a new bone, you know, replacement parts, that's where I would go, and if he's a delegate, I would be somewhere close to one.
Or someone who he would know would be somewhere close?
Yeah.
Aren't delegates like government people? Can't we just ask someone like, you know,
delegate is someone who is from another country or another place.
And you keep tabs on them because they're on the liabilities.
So we would have to ask the top dogs here to, because they would have to register inside the city as a delegate. Or they're at the embassy, if there is one here, for wherever they're a delegate for.
So Chad's got two options then, John. And weighing between the two, using the pipe.
You're just holding it right now. All these, you're having galaxy brain moments. I'm not even going to make you light up.
Okay.
We should go find, like, some guards and be like, yo, where's the government building?
That's... Say gods or guards?
Guards. Guards. Well, gods, maybe. I don't know. Then we not like gods.
You can go talk to one of the guards and be like, yo, where's the main government building? And they will point you up the hill at the very foreboding citadel up north. That is nestled.
Is the leader Count Dracula?
One guy laughs a little bit at the, you know, Count Dankula reference, but they shake their head. All the vampires died. Fresnoff killed them all. It's the whole thing with the Civil War.
I thought we saw vampires walking around. Or was that you?
Oh no, that's Ravik. Don't worry about him.
Huh. Alright. Can we hail a taxi?
We have a boat.
No. They don't even have carriages anymore. Like, all their servant class just fucking left the city. They're hiding out in the rural areas.
Didn't you say that there were armored vehicles?
Yeah, within the camp. They're not just gonna fucking drive you there, though. Why would they?
We'll show our passes, right? Wait, that's
can I threaten someone to drive us up there?
You can try, but no one in their right mind is gonna listen to you.
I want to try to intimidate someone to drive us up there.
Okay. Or he gets all puffy about
that. Syl just starts rolling up his sleeves. It's lightly raining right now. He sees an armored car unloading soldiers.
While he sees Syl getting ready to wizard strong arm these fucks and be like, hey, quick question. Y'all ever heard of someone named Grimir? Grimir the Grave? Perhaps? Skeleton delegate?
These two guards look at you. Both roll. That's a natural one and a natural three on any history checks. They shake their heads. Sorry, can't say I heard him. I met a Grimo. Like Grimo or something? But he was just like some dirtbag.
Can we talk to your manager?
Yeah, we want to talk to your manager.
Uh-oh, we're going full Karen.
I'm just going to go higher up. I
want to use my intimidation roll to...
Look, I don't know who you guys think you are, but, like, he just points to the big, like, cathedral-like structure in the center of this plaza. You should go up there if you want to talk with leadership.
Oh, is that closer? I feel like it is.
Yeah, you're right next to it. Yeah. You landed right next to it.
Cool, we'll walk to the plaza center.
I wanted to
This grand cathedral is a huge relic of past ages. It is a massive cathedral that is clearly far too big to have any practical, I suppose. It is too big for this to be considered like an operational structure. This is more like a landmark or a city center meetup. Chances are, like, over 2,000 people could easily fit within, like, the Grand Hall itself. It is huge and massive, and likely has a dope-ass, sick underground labyrinth that has never been explored before. But that's just the rumors. You guys can head on up the steps. There's, like, 70 of them. They're all wide. You pass by a statue of some defaced vampire lord or something in regal armor, but his face has just been smashed in by either mallets or hammers, made out of some kind of stone, probably marble. You head to two grand double doors that are made out of wood and metal. They do not have a clear locking mechanism, but... they have these massive iron rings which can be pulled or cracked open. And seemingly no, like, smaller postern door, like, at all. It's just these two huge ceremonious doors, which is already cracked open. Two guards stand in front of this crack, and they're like, "Yo, what's up?"
We were looking for a manager. Someone that has knowledge about Grimoire.
Yeah, who are you guys?
We're the Tolls Task Force.
You got your ID on you? Well, we can fast forward. You have your ID.
Robes. I do a kickflip. Let's go.
Okay. Oh, shit, you're Chad. We know of you.
Oh, good.
Yeah, you're the skateboard dude.
Glad my reputation precedes me.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about Grimir? Do you know of this skeleton delegate?
What? I'm just a guard.
Okay, well, to your manager, please.
They usher you inside. One of them gets on a communication device, and we will see who is here. Meza is out on the town fucking around with Revic. By out on the town, I mean out in the countryside. John looks at his Tulst Expeditionary Force. So we got Norm, we got Juliet, we got Majori, we always have Lady Grisilia, and we of course have Brilliant. Brilliant won't deal with you shitters, he's busy doing strategic level stuff, so I guess this is just a 1d3. A 1d4. It looks like Majori Kaplan and Lady Grisilia are currently in a logistical organizational hell, trying to figure out troop deployments and going over stuff. Devin, you are in the stream. You're in the stream chat. Go back to gambling your life savings away. Yeah, you see these two female captain equivalents. Oof, get wrecked. Who turn as you guys make a hubbub demanding to speak to somebody's manager.
Wait, who did you say comes up to us?
Lady Grisilia and Majori Kaplan. I suppose Lady Grisilia, an actual noble. Ding, 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 dings off your wizard radar, Ibor. You're like, holy shit, this is a wizard. Give me an arcana check to see how cool of a wizard she is.
Me?
Yeah, you. Ibor. Oh my god. She likely is of the 8th circle, which means she has access to 8th level spells. Damn is
I'll say
right.
It out loud. Damn.
Yep, she is in her early 40s. She is about 6 feet tall, has her blonde hair in a, well, currently it is hidden within a cap. And she is just a person with a staff at her hip. Like a small, short staff. It's maybe 2 feet or so long. The other person seems to be some kind of, like, warrior or martial fighter of kind of equal skill to you guys. Chances are that she is just, like, a pure officer who is here to fulfill a job rather than physically fight in combat.
Chad will take lead.
Oh, Chad. Lady, nice to meet you both. Lady Resilia knows you by name, apparently.
I'm glad my reputation precedes me again. Anyway, we don't mean to be much of a burden to you. We have a strange situation on our hands. We are looking to seek counsel with Grimir the Grave. Is that a friendly thing? He's a skeleton delegate. We don't have a whole lot of information we're running off of. Unfortunately, we're very short on time.
Lady Grisilia rolls a natural 19 on her history or knowledge check. And she kind of lowers her voice and looks at you guys, trying to... Why... How... Who gave you that name?
It's a very strange situation, and I apologize that I don't have much more detail. We're very short on time. One of our colleagues' lives is at stake.
Follow me. Majori, take care of this. And she sort of delegates this entire task of moving 2,500 people around an active and dynamic battlefield with an entire countryside. this one fifth level fighter who's like, what? And she beckons you guys to follow her. She will lead you into what appears to be like an officer's meeting area with a map of Destry, the region, not just the city. And John switches the map, scrolls up. Can you guys see the region map? Yes, you can. John will zoom out to the maximum. As she closes the door, she will put an arcane lock on it or do some sort of magic to stop prying eyes. And she will, in a hushed tone, look at you all and say, Grimir the Grave is a member of the Undead Legion. He was reported maybe 4 weeks ago north of Destry, beyond Fresnoth's domain, by the Discovery team. Were none of you informed of that? What is the purpose of your mission?
We need Grimir to come with us and speak with someone.
By force?
Doesn't have to be. We can make this peaceful.
He is an undead. Really, you know this, correct?
We've dealt with really, really strange forces. That the fact that someone has no life does not really bother me.
That's not what I mean. I mean, what?
I mean, is it not friendly? Can we not barter with this being? He's a skeleton delegate. We don't have a lot of information. Can you fill us in on the gaps that we don't have?
She does not know where to start. From what I understand, he is... And this is only from the reports that Runt, the Discovery team Hobbit made. Grimir is a creature that radiates death and cannot be touched, or his essence will ooze over you and kill you or something? I'm not sure myself. We've only heard tale of him. And he is apparently working in league or has some sort of bond with the warlord Fresnoth, who is our main enemy. There's a question about that, because it seems like he knows of her war crimes that she is committing and does not like them. But the undead work in mysterious ways. It's also been over a month since the Discovery team has seen him. Or near, too. She says, looking at her calendar. So yes, he was last seen in April.
So we need to go to Drizzle.
Yes, but... maybe. She points you to... and we'll draw a little thing. He was last seen in this village in the forest north. Apparently watching or keeping an eye out or doing something there. The Discovery team worked with him to get them across a trap within a murder temple made by some asshole. And then they fucked off and took a banner with them as payment, which we now use to as payment for the services of a mercenary.
So he helped the other team.
Yes, but it was like a quid pro quo kind of situation.
Well, it means that he can be bargained with. So that's always good news.
She nods.
Since you're a level 8 wizard, right? Or you,
no.
You can cast them or whatever. You're out of the 8th circle?
Yes.
You could send us there, couldn't you?
To where?
To where you suggested he might be. You just need a vague description. You can get somewhere near.
No. That's not how teleport, if that's what you're referring to, works. Also, I have duties here, and if I go with you, I would be going AWOL.
Well, I said send us, I didn't say...
I can't just send... anyway.
Would Debo know about that sort of magic of, like, just... or is...
That's probably, like... beyond the guy who can just cast fireball. Mass teleportation is a complicated thing. Literally changing someone's fixed position within the world isn't a common mode of transportation due to the inherent risks there are. I will tell you now, we have air supremacy within this region. There is a few frigates of Fresnoth that is still running around and avoiding a light cruiser we have hired. But, you know, if they see you make a beeline across their territory, they will undoubtedly investigate. There is a survivor from that town, which one of our members, not of the task force, but of the squad who went with them for security, they kidnapped against their will. Perhaps you should talk to them.
Great, let's go talk to them. Are they here, or are they up in that town?
They are currently bitching at the Overduke. They run a corpse brigade. A shop? No. Yeah. There is no market here. We hand out food to these poor, dirty people who have been socially and politically repressed for 5 years. This is not a place where you can... She just stops there.
Not with that attitude.
Anyway.
Alright.
Is there anything else I can help you with?
Point us in the direction of that person.
She points north towards the citadel. Which I will go and... There you go.
I say we go see if we can get any more leads from here before we leave.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You guys can leave.
Ybor, any ideas or any thoughts?
I had a thought of way of contacting Grimoire, but we'd need, like, sendy magic. Maybe we could just send him a message and be like, yo, do you want to come help us out? We can pay some gold. Because we don't know where he is. Maybe we can get in contact with some sort of magical means.
Chad's eyes dart between the spellcasters as they figure out how to magic the shit out of this.
Don't look at me, now you got that.
Wait, Stung flexes, because the magic is within his muscles.
No. Yeah, I only have message, which is within a visual sight of the person.
Dad doesn't have any magic. He's got a gun that can shoot sacred flame.
Fair. And a spear.
Ooh, yeah, I did get that back, didn't I? That's a fun one.
Yeah, that makes people horned.
Okay, you're reaching.
I'm sorry if it puts thornings on people.
Okay.
Making them thorny.
Okay.
I will ask if we're still with that woman. Does she actually know this creature, Grimoire?
She knows of the creature.
Would you be able to send him a message, maybe?
I would not do that lightly, no.
Can you do it heavy? Fat.
Let's roll fatness for it. How insulted is she? She looks at you, and we'll do a reaction adjustment still. Oh! She hates you still. This was a personal insult to her honor, and... She straight up tells you, I would magic missile you to death right here, right now, if it was not part. Oof. You're lucky, mister. She flicks your nose and fucks off.
Can I throw a biscuit at her? Or a ration at her head?
Just throw 2 pounds of food!
Chad's gonna try to intervene and be like, hey, why don't you drink some of Daddy's special juice? You seem cranky today, bud. Have you drank today?
No.
It seems like you need a drink. Well, what are you waiting for? It's today, isn't it?
Well, it's not noon yet.
It's afternoon.
That stopped you before.
Yeah, you're right. Alright.
Go take a lap. You'll be fine.
Still pops open some daddy's happy juice.
Chad attempts to apologize for the offended lady.
You can do so, but she's a busy person, and she's delegated, someone who is unfit for her job.
Thank her for her time, and then we head off to a person who's in castle thing.
Alright. You guys can head northward through the light drizzle of Destry, crossing by several... people who are kind of milling about or, like, trying to repair the structures that are most livable and easiest to repair so that they can live within them. Most of the town beyond around this line, like the villages closest to, or not the villages, the houses closest. Houses closest to the citadel have just been flat out leveled, turned into rubble. People aren't even like fucking around there. So once you like hit that line, you will like just walk through destruction that has been turned into like this mushy state, a mire of building materials and rain that has just been pooled and is stagnating. You'll even pass like this trench line that has been like filled with water at this point, creating like a moat of sorts, which you guys can pass through. There are some Ulithaeans, which many of you know of but have never seen. The splint mail clad foreign warriors from far to the north, the tyrant's personal allies, who kind of work here as like an extra layer of security, but it looks like they are like finally packing up now that the expeditionary force isn't at like direct threat by Fresnoth anymore. Still, some of them guard the main gate with a few of the Tolst expeditionary force, as well as this like heavily armored plate mail wearing knight who just has this massive, almost tree trunk like maul in his hands. And as you approach the gate, he quickly steps past the Ulithaeans, shoves the Tulse guard, finds a Destry citizen soldier who's like, ah! And he just, like, punches him in the face, just in this show of violence, and he, like, stands to, who challenges the gate guard of the Overduke? I am the Branch Knight, identify yourselves.
Wait, are you Club Branch?
No.
Oh.
I'm the Branch Knight.
Oh, sorry. We're with the Tulse Squad. We're looking for someone. Are you able to help us?
Can I help? Of course I can help you. You need my services?
Sure, why not?
What do you need?
We're looking for a Grimir the Grave.
Never heard of him.
No, we're looking for someone griping with the Overlord.
Ah, which one?
That person.
Is it the weird elf creature who looks like a hobbit mixed with a ham sandwich? Or is it the undead lady who just hangs out with all the corpses?
That sounds the right one.
Yes, let me show you. She is... When was she last here? She's probably bitching at the Overduke right now, at this exact second. Follow me!
That sounded like the description.
It's quite humorous. Follow me.
Did you say humorous because it's a bone?
He laughs like a maniac. Puts on his knightly helmet with a big plume of like greenish and purplish material. And leads you inside a pretty barren citadel. If this is like the main government structure, it does not have like a staff or population to fulfill that role. Many of the hallways which he leads you down are completely empty. Many doors are just, like, open, and as you, like, kind of pass them, you see just empty rooms that have just been thrown sheets over furnitures. Some are just completely barren. There's, like, one bookshelf which it looks like has been pilfered through by, like, a horse or something with how much shit has been, like, knocked around. It's not a great place, and when he finally gets you to, like, a throne room, you see it's, like, a literal stool that is just put down in the middle, and there's just this, like, sad-looking 50-year-old man who's just, like, wearing a regal-like cloak with, like, spots and great furs and all sorts of stuff. It's quite an exquisite, like, robe and cloak set that he's wearing, and he's just being yelled at by, like, a gravedigger who's complaining that, why is there no you have to do something, Overduke. This is pathetic leadership. There are literally dead people just rotting in the middle of the street, growing fungus out of them because of all the rain. Why aren't you saying it? And he's just, like, staring blankly forward. And it's just like, yeah, I understand. And then the Branch Knight will kind of go, ahem! and get the two people's attention. I introduce Task Force of Tolst. 2, 3?
Go in, this is your cue, approach!
He whispers.
Chad walks forward. Hello, sorry to interrupt. I believe you might...
Oh, thank God.
Undead lady. You might be able to help us.
The Overduke, like, is so happy. He's like, finally, somebody needs me to be their puppet. And then he's like, oh, you guys don't need me at all. And, like, shrinks down in the stool even further, hunching over. And the woman looks at this pathetic shamble of a man and approaches you guys. I cannot speak with this eyesore in the same room as me. Follow.
Sounds good.
You guys step out of that room, close the door, and then she will speak with you. The Branch Knight will depart.
Chad'll say to the Overduke, you'll get him next time, champ.
Yeah. And just, like, starts, like, and cries.
Good. That's all Chad needed.
Let me look at what this person is called and if they have a description. You are looking at a 26, 27-year-old female of average looks. She has rather a pale complexion, as though she hasn't seen the sun in a while, which, fun fact, no one has here. They hold themselves high. They seem to be looking everybody in the eye and stare you down with a... rather courageous look on their face. I mean, she's staring down six killers wearing a lot of magical items, and she appears to be armed with only, like, a trowel. What?
Rimmer,
hello?
The grave. Do you
yes?
know of this creature? We wish to seek and speak with it and hopefully have it come with us to save someone's life.
This...
I know, it's a lot. We have a lot of death contracts on our heads.
No, I get it.
Trying to get one settled. You apparently are the closest, most recent to interact with Grimir.
Yes.
Maybe you can point us in the right direction.
North. Go beyond Fresnos territory, into the forest where the sun shines. At night, his undead legionnaires can often be found. Or they could be found. I found them there.
Great.
Anything
Chad
else?
Chad, should we worry of this creature? Is it peaceful enough if we try and speak with it?
I've spoken with him many times, but it is difficult to understand him.
What would one need to speak with this thing?
Tongue, I assume?
Well,
an open check. Mind, truly.
Check.
I hope.
Oh, then I guess we're good.
I mean, we could talk to him telepathically, too.
So you can do that?
Yeah.
Neat. Done.
One so giant bug man apparently spoke with him via comprehend languages. You have that.
Oh, I can do that.
Pretty sure Ybor's got us on that account as well.
Yeah.
Then I wish you luck, young...
Grasshopper?
I'm Chad.
Creature?
And you?
I'm sorry?
I said, I'm Chad. And you?
My name is Luna. No last name. I am a peasant.
Oh, cool. I only have one name, too.
Oh, you must be a peasant as well.
Something like that.
She nods her head in understanding. Well, if you need anything else, I will be bitching at the Overduke to get his people in line, so that we can...
It seems like a real piece of work.
Yeah, he's a coward. And a weak-willed bitch.
Yeah, he thought I was pointing at him. What a turd.
Yeah, self-aggrandizement, attention from vampires, apparently, makes you a weak-willed individual. So, I'm gonna go harass him some more.
Chad thinks for a moment, reaches in his bag, gives her a jar of dirt, and says, I don't know if this will come in more handy to me than you, but go harass that man.
She takes the dirt, opens the jar lid, sniffs it. Where did Gorgor get this jar of dirt, Syl? Oh, it looks like Syl's fighting someone in real life.
Sorry, Gorgor got... Where did Gorgor get dirt?
Yeah, where did Gorgor get his jars of dirt from?
It came from, from the Isles.
Oh, from Mokapuni?
Yeah.
Damn. She sniffs this soil that is exotic. Says, wow, this is incredibly rich. I smell the sulfur within it. And then she closes it and, like, puts it in, like, a small side bag that she has on her. I will treasure this gift forever. Thank you.
Well, thank you for the information. I'm glad you liked the dirt.
Indeed.
And he thinks back to Gorgor and was like, shit, did he just give me something good? We're gonna have to get more dirt from Gorgor.
She puts the jar of dirt away and will head back into the room to harass and harangue this man called the Overdue.
Thanks, Luna. And then we fuck off.
You fuck off! Easy enough.
Is this a thing we can just hop in our airship and, like, scope out to try and find, like, you know, some giant radius of death or undead warriors from above?
Potentially, yeah.
Well, they said we have air superiority, and technically, since we're not in a ship that has any sign of who it belongs to, it's a raiding ship.
As we check in with that first person we talked to, the government building person, and let them know, hey, please don't shoot down our boat.
Yeah. You can quickly check in and say, you guys have a working communicator on your vessel?
Yes.
All right.
Chad refers to his communicator and is like, "What frequency are you on? Is that a thing we're allowed to
do?" We have no airships currently. We have hired a mercenary captain named Rick Silverback to gain blood vengeance against the one who wronged him, which just so happens to be Fresnoth. His contract expires next year, so she shrugs. Contact him?
Do you have his frequency? Or is there a way to just start
cycling? He will hail you if he sees you. He should not shoot immediately. He knows what Fresnoth's ships have built. If we see him, we will give him the alert of what your ship is described as. Looks like a crappy Corvette.
That's the one.
She nods.
Zenoth's Revenge should be painted on the side.
I see. I will tell them that Xenos Revenge and not Betrayal shall not be shot down.
Oh shit, is it Betrayal? Fuck. Fuck, it's Xenos Betrayal. Damn it, I didn't look at the...
It's fine. All my notes are in my head.
Something dark side, something.
There's a lot of goddamn names.
Ask her about the moon. The name Luna can't be a coincidence. So, you remember Luna, right? From your first character?
Yeah. The Grave Keeper.
Yep, same person.
Yep.
Okay.
Oh, she's undead now, too?
She's not undead, no.
I thought you just said she's undead.
She looks like she's undead.
Oh, yeah. She tried becoming a supermom in the beginning of her life, and she never could gain back her weight.
True. Mm-hmm. You guys can... Well, you can't hop in immediately. You have to wait until tomorrow. But, if there's anything else you want to do in Destry, or we could fast forward till tomorrow when your airship can fly again.
Apparently not shopping.
You said there's a bunch of vehicles here, right?
Yep.
Is there anything we would be able to barter with to try and see if we could buy one of these land vehicles off of them?
They're not for sale.
I mean, everyone here is super poor. I'm pretty sure we can...
It's not the citizens, it's Tulst that has brought these things. They're military vehicles, or APCs.
They are unmarked.
What? Are they unmarked? No, they're all marked! They have all their identifications, everyone has a license plate. Squads are attached to them. Ebor is just a car thief in the making.
Wait, are we getting a Grand Theft Auto this?
I mean, I'm down.
I don't know. There's a lot of military shit that I don't really want to get shot at with.
True. While you're here, I can give you basic information about, like, the current, battle state of the region. More or less, Fresnoth is pillaging and raiding villages and, like, ranches and isolated farmsteads. And just, like, harassing them on this line. She is trying to make a pocket within this forest and are being met in skirmishes with Destry, or specifically with the expeditionary force of Tolst's peacekeepers. She's doing war crimes to force Tolst to actually come out of Destry and, like, fight her, which is working. So, like, every few hours, a report will come in, and then several vehicles will depart with many squads of people to go and combat her and her vassals, I suppose, her followers. So, taking a land route through most of this place is... Well, you will undoubtedly be spotted. Most of the time, cars outrun horses. So... I mean, it's not, like, a big deal if you're spotted on land, but... I mean, you guys will be in an airship, right? Who gives a shit?
Yep.
So, as you guys meet with your crew, and Igor, for whatever reason, doesn't take over and hijack the orders of his crew, what sort of path do you guys want to follow? How are you guys going to get to this village?
A direct path?
Well, the alternative, right, is avoiding that line that John drew. Like, can't we take a super dumb route thing? Right? Is this actual mileage accurate,
yep.
John? Or,
it sure is.
Shit, then let's go around the death line. If this is only, like, 100 miles, this will take us, like, a couple minutes, right?
Take you an hour.
Yeah, okay. Let's avoid the person terrorizing villages for now.
That being said, the entire region is split like this, with the north half of this line just all being within Fresnoth's domain. So,
direct route it is. Let's go.
Okay.
Yay! Battle!
Direct route.
Okay.
It's an hour one way or another. Go there quickly.
Doing a direct route, you need to go around this mountain.
Sure.
Yeah, it will take you like 45 minutes to get to this village, which will happen tomorrow on the 22nd. Raid Destry. And with that, your course set, your boat ready during the early morning. You guys can set out. And with that, we're going to take our first break of this evening. And when we see you on the other side, we will head on over and try to find an undead legionnaire. So see you in a bit, guys. Hello, everybody. We are back. You guys set off on a early morning, I guess, blitz to the north. John will roll for rain. It is indeed raining heavily. You guys plow through the rain, creating this pretty sick streaking effect as rain is just dispersing and hitting your craft. Everyone is inside the airship as you guys blitz through. 45 minutes later, you will pass through a, or pass over a village. And not even like 4 miles away, there's just a clear break from the rain to like dry land. And it is like very noticeable as you guys are getting rained on.
When we're getting near the end of the journey, I'd like to start ritually casting Comprehend Languages as it lasts an hour. So
okay.
I'd get a decent amount of use out of it after we land.
You begin casting the spell, and by the time you are over the village, the crew looks to Igor, and you guys are Igor right now. Like, what are we doing, sir? Where are we dropping you off? Pachinki?
A big open spot where there's no rain.
Understood! We're getting out of Destry, boys! There's cheers from the pirates and, from the crew. The lack of Schmitty's wails is unsettling to you all. You have grown fond of him screaming in pain, having to eat rats for sustenance rather than food he would prepare for you guys. Jesus Christ. Into the break you go, and suddenly, within a few minutes, you are outside of rain. It is a beautiful spring morning. It's maybe 6 in the morning right now, and you are out of a dark, hellish nightmare, and into a beautiful sunrise. Are we just dropping you into the trees? What's the plan?
In this weird spot, is there, describe this area, that we're looking for like a zone of death, right, or some strange, weird occurrence, so like this seems strange and weird enough.
Yeah, kinda.
To the wizard folk and be like, does this look right to y'all?
If it looks like everything's unnaturally dead, then yes.
It is a spooky pine forest. You are within the sea of trees, an unmapped region, on this part of the world, I suppose.
Does it look within the area? Does it look like there's any area that has like a lot, like a circular, a lot of area that is dead?
Make a perception check, Syl, as you go, stand outside, look over the edge, feel the wings on your back within the air, these diminutive swan wings attached to your hips, poking through your robes. Okay. Syl, what does a natural one look like? As you hold true to your curse of never seeing anything useful until ever.
God damn it. Now, if this was like an intimidation roll like I was trying to do, I have a fucking plus 10 to that.
True.
I have.
What does
a
one look like, though? That's what I want to know.
I just see trees.
Alright, you just see pine trees all over the place.
Oh. Will I get advantage on a, do the trees look bad because I have a tree in my back?
You need to interact with the trees more so than just look at them.
Fair.
Does having my familiar give me the advantage roll?
You're familiar? No.
Having the helping hand?
You do you want to yeet your familiar down there and be like, find me trees, bitch?
We can use it as a scout, right? Or it can go check real quick for us?
Yeah.
Question mark?
Technically,
but yeah.
I have to be extremely specific on the wording, though.
Just so you guys know, chances are you were spotted.
Is there, talking to the pilot crew, is there a spot you guys can lay low and not necessarily land, but just chill out for a while?
We can mill above the canopy.
Alright.
This time is probably better, since we still have, you know, 90% of our mileage we can travel.
We have
rather than
gondola.
The, like, 30.
We have that gondola thing that can take us down, right?
Yep.
Let's use that instead of burning all our feather falls right away.
We probably want to find a clearing. Everyone! Go look on deck! Find me a clearing for us to do some shenanigans over. Everyone
like it.
May roll perception. Wow, that was like my fourth natural one that I've rolled.
Can I roll again then?
No, you have done yours.
Damn it. There
well,
we go.
Chad sees it. What about Ebor?
Oh, I was going to be doing the ritual casting. So
You could have that done by now if you want.
Oh, okay. Perception.
Okay.
I'm blind as well.
You are blind as well. Chad, you are the first to spot a clearing just for the sake of landing. You direct the captain slash pilot over to it. And he will do a weird anchoring maneuver in the trees and, like, circle around for a few minutes, killing his momentum until finally you guys are able to descend properly. Ooh. My allergy medicine's kicking in. Jesus.
You getting sleepy?
My eyes just want to stay open there for a second. Okay. You can descend whenever you wish to. Igor will, of course, go with you, because what if you need to fight? And he also can detect undead. Or sense, evil shit.
Obviously, they shun will come along because yep. It's his fucking life on the line.
True.
All right, so off we go to search for some skeleton delegate here.
You descend into the wood. None of the trees seem to be dead, but as you descend and touch the ground, a strange atmosphere will surround you guys. It's a little bit too windy, a little bit too dark within these pine forests that you are in. This small clearing was on a hill, so when you guys got to the slope, you had to, like, step off on random or awkward angles. Igor and Leishtung will come down last. And you guys are in a forest, in a clearing, somewhere outside of Destry. Off the map, as it were. What's the plan here, Skippers?
Look for this guy.
You're just gonna meander through the woods?
We could just start screaming Marco.
Igor has... What's the range on his detect?
60 feet.
That sucks.
Yep. Yeah, it does.
I don't have access to anything Igor has. Other wizard folk, what fun shenanigans can you help with here?
I'll send my familiar out.
I can send my familiar the opposite direction. Then we've got two directions being checked.
Yo, we got some scouts.
Alright.
We can head forward in a direction towards the center of what we saw of that clearing. Send out the scouts in sort of like a fork sort of thing as we move forward, cover more ground.
That works for me.
Okay. Keeping your familiars within 100 feet so you can command them. You can do this in a weird wedge formation. Ebor, what does your familiar look like?
It's an owl. It's quite a small one because it's meant to be a bit relative to myself, so I imagine a little owl, like a dwarf owl.
This is a little sparrow-like owl flutters, a hummingbird-like owl flutters past being easy prey for any avian creature hunting. You guys can enter the woods, leaving the clearing behind, and enter the spooky dark woods filled with treacherous things.
We would have made sure that someone was near the communicator this time.
Yes, of course. Someone you can trust. Maybe even two, some son of a bitch. Alright.
Onward.
We need to take a quick break. As I set up a battle map immediately.
Yay!
You guys are gonna get like 300 feet into the forest when some shit's about to go down.
We did it. We avoided combat.
Oh.
We're gonna save everyone's life. Stay tuned, everyone.
Oh my god. Alright, we'll be right back, guys. No, you cannot play Igor, JC. Fuck off. Oh. There we go. Wrong button, guys. Sorry about that. Welcome to the scuffed MS Paint map, everybody. We are traveling through a forest. I have given you guys these circles which represent pine trees. And as we travel through it, I need everyone to tell me their passive perception. Because Igor's and Weishtung's are trash.
Oh, wait, no. Passive perception?
Yes, passive 13. Perception.
11 for me, but my elders have
10.
Jesus.
All right.
Chad wins? No way. 13?
13 is our highest passive perception. Igor's is 8. Pseudo Dragons is 13 as well. So,
actually, isn't there a thing about if you have advantage on perception, then you gain a bonus to your passive perception? Because my owl has a 13 and it has advantage, so it would have like an 18 passive.
That is for checks. I don't believe that confers to passive, otherwise it would say passive perception 18 instead of 13.
Okay. Fair enough.
John's looking for his d20s. Because he's going to be secret rolling this stuff. Because he never finished automating these creatures that are coming out of hiding. Gentlemen, you are in the woods. In the woods. When there is a mighty crack of wood splintering, tree branches. Pine cones, all sorts of manner of forest shrubberies being upchurned to your... Let's roll a d8 for direction. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Towards the pseudo-dragon. Your pseudo-dragon gets to around right here when it spots, kind of close to it, this strange monster. Half lion, half statue. This creature with red eyes and obsidian skin pops out of hiding. Or more like gets bumped into by a thing that was pathetic enough to try to ambush you. Okay, cool. John's music. Where is John's music? And as your pseudo dragon runs into it, it will telepathically and physically screech out a warning, alerting you all to this potential threat. What's Dark Angel sound like? Music start? Music's not starting? Endgame, maybe? There we go. Music has restarted. Alrighty. I need everyone to click their tokens and roll for initiative as we enter combat. And I will roll our boy Igor nice. And Leishtung. Group initiative.
Ushim and Nav?
Or Igor and Leishtung.
Oh, that's cool. How'd you get their characters like show up like that?
I'm a god. For the purposes of familiars, they go immediately after you. Sound good?
Yep.
Okay. Descending order, and then John has to roll one more thing in secret. Where are you? Fuck. Okay. Sending order, perfect. Why does it say Kushima Nav on my turn order? What the fuck? Alright, Murder Beast goes first. It sees your little squawker scout and will just attack it. Stabbing it in the face with one of its claw attacks. Rolling a natural 17, hitting it, and It will minimally do 6 damage. Your pseudo dragon sill immediately explodes as this beast stomps towards you, uncaring, moving its 40 movement speed to there. Sill, it's your turn.
All right, well, now I'm fucking pissed.
Yep.
Do I have clear sight of him?
Do you have clear sight of him? He's right in front of you, yes.
Well, okay, so if I were to use Shooting Star, my 3 of them, I can hit directly at him?
Remind me what that does. I assume so, if you need sight. Am I getting messaged by someone? Something wrong with the stream?
No, I posted what perfect. Shooting Star does.
No, you're good. You expend 1 to 3 charges. How many charges?
I'm going to shoot 3.
All right. You spend 3 of your charges. For every charge you expend, you launch a glowing mote of light within the ring at a point you can see within 60 feet of you. He's well within 60 feet. Each creature within a 15-foot cube originating from that point is showered in sparks and must make a DC 15 dex save. Or take 5d4 fire damage on a failed, half as much on a successful one. I assume that's per charge?
Yeah, 5d6 per charge.
Oh my god.
So he has to do dex save throw for each one.
Alright, this is at plus 4 to this, and it's DC 15. Natural 16 will pass the DC, but please roll me 15d4 fire damage. Click that bottom one underneath the 8.
So 6.
That is your first set of 5. Do that 2 more times.
Fuck.
Alright, so 12, 16, 36 fire damage, which he halves and then halves again. So what is that? He is resistant to fire.
Half of 36 is 18, half of that is 9.
9.
So what does he have to, yeah. He has to do a dex saving throw for each one. It's a separate thing.
It does not tell me that with what you have linked me. I assume this is you, like, Omega casting this, rather than sending out 3. Right? Because this isn't, like, magic missile. This is...
I think it is, like, magic missile, because I can put 3 charge. Separate ones.
For each charge, a thing of light comes out and causes sparks.
Yeah, it's each... 3 separate.
For every charge,
I can
send
to 3 separate locations.
Oh. Okay. Hang on. So it passed its first one.
So that's 3 damage so far.
Natural 20 on the second one. So that's another 6. Or that's another 3. And then it will. Fail by 1. So it's gonna take 5.
That's
then it's
11.
Going to
11 total.
Take 6 more. Perfect. There we go. You got an extra, 2 hit points off of that for lawyering? Good job. That was your action. What's your bonus action?
I think at this point, I think I'm gonna just kinda meander yonder.
All right, you run away, like the coward you are. Chad, it's your turn.
I'm gonna chuck the bloody thorn at it.
You chuck the bloody thorn at it. Make an attack roll, please. A 15. Let me check this guy's AC. I believe that will hit. You will just hit it. Roll for damage. For 7. It is a magical weapon, so you will be doing full.
And then the weird effect kicks in, which I was digging around for, and I thought I had copy-pasted. It's somewhere in my items.
I will look for it. Magical items. Bloody Thorn. Here we go. I am going to link you the full item if you have lost it, just to help you out a little bitty bit.
Put it right where I've got the detective pipe, so I don't lose it again.
There you go. That is a wall of text. I'm sorry, it looks different on my Word document. It's a little bit more spaced out. Upon throwing this weapon at a creature, briar-like vines begin to sprout out and wrap around the target, attempting to restrain it. The creature must make a DC 14 strength save or become restrained. If one does not grapple the spear by its wrapped handles, thorns will sprout out from the spear shaft, making all attempts to free the creature at disadvantage. Any attempt to free the restrained creature and fail a DC 14 athletics check become poisoned for 1d4 rounds. A convoluted item, it will roll its DC 14 strength save. Oh my god, that's off the table. Getting a natural 15. Wow, this guy, you are eating up his good rolls. So he is not restrained, but you do stab it.
Got a fuck ton of movement. I can comfortably run up, use my extra attack to bash him.
Mm-hmm.
And then run back. I am attempting to stun him in the process, and that's exactly what I'm going to do. So I'm going to run up.
All right. You run up. Bop. 25 feet. A 14 will not hit.
But I can focused aim, spending a chi point to bump that up by 2 points.
A 16 will hit.
Damage is in this window.
And 8. I'm going to Are your fists magical yet?
No.
Okay. Oh, and you stunning strike it. It is perfect. Please roll. No, I need to roll a con check for him. Getting a 5.
That's definitely higher than what it, or not as high as it needs to be. Ooh, it's stunned.
Yes, he is super stunned. All further attacks to hit him will be at advantage. Yeah, snail. Okay.
Could I, while I'm here, three object interaction, get my bloody thorn back, and then run back, or is that too many things in one turn?
You can do that, yeah.
Do that, and then I will end my turn running back saying, hey, we've got a free round, boys, he's stunned. Fuck him up.
Okay, Lei Shtung, I assume, rages and runs into combat with his 30 movement speed. Does anyone want to roll? I'll just do it myself. He only has one attack, bleh, 19 will hit. 12 damage. Wow, that's max damage for him.
14 with the rage, right?
Yep. Oh, 14, yes. There we go, perfect. Extra 2. That's all he's got, though, so Ibor, it's your turn.
He doesn't have double attack yet?
Nope. He's a multi-class.
He's got a weird multi-class.
I will bonus action start the blade song.
Mm-hmm.
So I now have the...
Wow, that's a lot. Movement. You gain AC equal to your intelligence modifier. Your walking speed increases by 10 feet. You have advantage on dexterity acrobatics checks. And you gain a bonus to any con saving throws you make to maintain your concentration on a spell. Perfect.
And I was going to cast Maximilian's Earth and Grasp.
Okay.
On the creature.
You choose a 5-foot square of unoccupied space on the ground, so within 5 feet. Denote this right now.
No.
That is not 5 feet. That is 2.5 feet.
Oh.
So 2 squares.
Yep, 2 squares. The target must make a strength saving throw. On a failed save, the target takes 2d6 bludgeoning damage and is restrained for the spell's duration. Cool.
I think it fails because it's stunned or something.
That is for dex, not for strength. I know that much. You don't just auto-fail your saves.
The creature automatically fails strength and dexterity saving throw.
Are you fucking kidding me? Stunned condition. Is this not paralyzed? Stunned is something else entirely, isn't
Stun's
it?
Stun's the different... We do this every time.
Yeah.
Yeah, we did this last time, too.
Okay.
It's its own effect.
Yeah.
Stunned. Incapacitated. Cannot move. Can speak falteringly. auto fails strength and dex saving.
Okay,
throws.
Then it fails its strength save.
Attack rolls against the creature have advantage. That's it.
Perfect. That is not unoccupied space. Can you move that into unoccupied space, please? There you go. Okay, it fails its strength check and takes 2d6 damage. Please roll it. Rolling. And this is bludgeoning damage?
Yes.
Alright, it will suffer 1 point of damage and is restrained. Perfect.
Is it resistant to force damage? Or bludgeoning damage?
Yep. Okay. Igor!
And I'll move back away from it.
Dope. I assume...
Igor's gonna run up and smash it, right?
Yep.
If he gets a crit, he's gonna do the smite?
Yep.
Isn't that...
That's what he does. Alrighty. Weapon. Here we go. 26 will strike it for 15. Oh my god. It is a Warhammer or a great Maul plus 1. And he does have extra attack. A 13 will miss, unfortunately. And now the second one will come out of hiding with its natural 16 stealth check, which surpassed everyone's passive perception. He was just on the other side of a tree, apparently. Oh, its health bar didn't roll. What in the fuck? Oh, no, it did. Is it on the map layer now? Yeah, it's on the map layer. I misclicked. Lamau. Alrighty. Murder Beast number 2 will move up 40 or 35 feet to where Igor is. And will it breath weapon? Can it reach you? No, there's no way in hell it will be able to reach you too, Chad. That's unfortunate. Okay, well, it's going to hit Igor and Leishtung. It will breath weapon. Igor and Leishtung must make dexterity saving throws of DC 14. So that is a 19 from Leishtung. And then for Igor, plus 1 to that. Wait, okay, yeah. Natural 19 doesn't matter if he has proficiency to it. Okay, so Igor will fail. Where are my d6s? Blech. Blech. Ah! Alright. I love d6s, guys. They're my favorite dice. I even built a whole mass combat module based off them. That
Hi,
is...
YouTube. See you in VOD land.
12... 16... 18... 20... 25 fire damage.
Something, something, Igor gets reduced damage, something, something, stone
yeah,
skin.
I'm looking at his fucking stone skin. What does stone skin do? Yeah.
D12 plus whatever his con is.
It is 2. So, D12 plus 2. Who wants to roll that? Someone roll that for me.
Whoever had, yeah, I was gonna say, don't, someone who's like, oh!
Yikers! Sorry, Igor, I love you.
So that is 6, turns to 19 fire damage rather than 25. Whoa, that's negative 25.
Minus 2 more, because heavy weapon armor.
That does nothing against fire damage.
Cool.
Mm.
Worth a shot.
There we go. Igor is hurt. Leishtung passed his save, so he suffers 12 instead. And unfortunately, he's not a bear.
Does that get halved even more since he's raging?
He's raging.
No, but he does have hellish resistance, which is even better. So we will give him plus 6 to that. Barely suffering any damage, taking quarter damage. This guy is stunned and restrained until Chad's next turn. So Chad, oh no, excuse me, Syl, it's up to you.
All right. We're going to. Keep going after that one, and we'll Eldritch Blast it.
Alright, you have advantage on these shots, so 21 will hit. And a 30 will hit.
Fucking 30.
Casual plus 11 to hit.
Yeah.
For 9, that is correct, and 14.
23? 23.
Yep.
And then I'll expend 3.
You're going to use your healing now?
What's his health? I'm sorry, I can't read that.
No, you're good. It is at 24.
24 out of 40-something.
Yeah, he's at half. I'll expend 3.
Okay, roll me 3d6. Nice.
Fucking hell.
Good. He gains 6 hit points back, and you can stay there, your movement. You should not be able to get hit this turn. Chad, it's your turn.
Let's do a quick maths.
Yep, you're going to try to stunning strike them both?
Yeah, I'm just trying to path it so I don't get...
No, I get it. You're a level 5 monk. This is all you
do. Am I able to squeeze, like, between... After hitting the guy on the left, am I able to squeeze between Igor and the thing on the left, or is there no space?
Normally, I would say no, but it is stunned and restrained, so there's two kinds of CC on it, and it cannot, like, do anything to you to squeeze through stuff. So, yeah, yes, you can.
Excellent. So, Chad's gonna rush up. There, please. And then to here for 30.
I eagerly await to see you fly. Perfect. Can I not have you in his square? Can I move you there?
Perfect. Okay, cool. I'm going to hit him with the mace.
The stun guy?
The stunned one is first. Yeah, I'm passing him. Okay, cool. So he gets hit. I will expend a chi to try and stun him for another round.
Oh, hang on. Shit. There we go. Minus 11. Okay. He will make a con saving throw. Rolling. Natural one. He is stunned again.
Excellent. I spin around. I will...
Rolling.
So I'll use my extra attack. Mace the other guy, swing around, whop.
An 18 will hit.
For 11
again, nice.
Come on, stunning strike, don't fail me now. Go 3 for 3.
That, I believe, is a pass. What's your DC?
Oh, that's a great question. It's what, 8 plus...
Plus whiz and proficiency.
I think it's in chi. 8 should... plus prof plus whiz.
So
8 plus 3 plus 3 is 14.
Okay, then it will pass.
Oof.
Just barely.
Okay. I get one more unarmed strike, so I'm going to kick this thing on my way out.
It will miss.
Yikers. And then I'm going to... I used 30, maybe 35 to get there. I'm going to scoot this way. Think. My
perfect.
15 feet. And the other thing can't hit me because mobile.
Indeed. Leishtung's turn is now. And Leishtung will swing at this creature that is almost dead. He is raging. He is longswording with a 25. With a 11 plus 2 is often 13. Whoa. Almost killing the creature, but not quite. What would Leishtung move to? Would he trusts Igor. He'll go fight this guy. He'll actually spend more movement to get out of breath weapon range. Maybe
does
he wouldn't do that.
Does he have any sort of fighter bullshit? Like second wave, second wind, where he could hit again?
I thought he did.
Because isn't he a barb fighter? Remind me.
He is 2 fighter and 3 barb... Oh, he's Path of a Totem, too. Oh, I didn't know he was Path of a Totem. What's his fucking thing? Is he bear? Yeah, he's a bear. What the fuck? Oh well. You can't get multiple resistances, unfortunately. Okay. His weight is all fucked.
Is it because of the money?
No, he never set his fucking inventory. He's heavily encumbered. He's been heavily encumbered. I'm gonna go through all of your sheets.
He has those boots and he doesn't get encumbered, I think, doesn't he?
So. Oh, is that why he unchecked it? Yes, that is why he unchecked it. Perfect. Thank you so much. I was like, I was about to be like, what the fuck is happening? He moves there. He could action surge. I don't think he's gonna. Ebor. Thank you. Ebor, take your turn. This guy auto fails his strength save. The inventory audit begins. Yes. This is all true. Oh, my camera's a little fallen. Yeah. Look at my head. What's up, Ebor?
Yeah, I'm just gonna do the grasp again.
You don't want to fireball your team?
No, they're in the way. So, I won't this time. So, it's 2d6 damage because it automatically fails.
Indeed we do. For 6, have 2, 3. Is that your action or bonus action?
It's
your bonus
action,
right? Oof.
No, it's the action to do it.
Oh, okay. Can you re-link the spell? Just so I can look at it again. Yes, it is your action. Perfect. Okay. Well, it can't break out, so you are good to go. I guess you can chill there?
Yeah.
Alright. Igor is going to try to finish off a stunned creature. He probably won't even smite it if he rolls a natural 20. Yeah.
Good thing you said that.
Yeah, he fucking kills it outright. It immediately splinters apart into fancy little particles as he then turns around and will hit this guy at normal. Bleh. For another 25. Jesus. For 16. Should he smite? I'm asking the team. Do you think he would smite here?
Yeah, he... Oh, no. If he critted? Well...
Yeah. This is weird territory where I would lean to probably not.
Okay, then we're not going to do it. This creature will go, see if its breath weapon recharges on a 5 or 6, rolls a 4, and it will maul. Who can it maul? It doesn't like the guys who are hitting it. And although, Chad, you did hit it and try to stun it, it doesn't like Igor more. So it will do just that. It has a plus 8 to this. Nice. It will claw, bite. We'll do the claws at the same time. Natural 1 and a 14 plus 8 is often higher than most armor classes. Then it's bite. An 8 plus an 8 is a 16. So we'll only hit Igor once. 4. 2d6 plus a number. 5, 2, and then... Well, simple math. It has plus fucking 4 damage, so... 6 plus 5 is 11 points of slashing, which is then minus 3 to 8?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. And this spirit beast is dead, bringing us back to Syl's turn. Guys, this wasn't such a hard fight, now that you have Stunning Strike Monks.
Right? We're gonna stick with just Eldritch Blasting it.
Alright, they're at normal. 18 hits. 25 hits. 10... An 8 18. Is often 18. Oh my god.
Get wrecked, spirit beast.
Is it dead, or does it have like a sliver?
John did like minus 1.
Oh my god. I can't remember what it was at, and now I've hit it too many times to go back.
Oof.
We'll say it was at like 58 or something. Yeah, that looks more right on a fractional basis. I think it was at 57, actually. So we'll give you an extra point of damage.
Yeah.
You take it below half. And it becomes Chad's turn.
Yeah, I was gonna say I'm not doing shit.
Okay. Eh, look at Silver Cowering. You run up.
It's looking pretty rough. I'm gonna hold on to my remaining chi point. I'm just gonna beat the shit out of him.
Cool. Miss.
Bop.
Hit.
Bop.
Seven. Are you going to punch it with your offhand?
Of course, yep. I'm gonna punch it with my offhand.
Alright.
For
well, that is
damage
a
sh- in my magical maze.
Something. Have, though. So.
Six. Or five.
There we go. Lei Shtung is going to join you. You can move now. It's, you know, it's
yep.
whatever.
Just get enough out of range that two opportunity attacks will probably kill it.
Yep. Longsword. Blep. Blep. Oh, weak. Weak longsword. Seven. Ebor.
I'm gonna do a firebolt.
Alright. You don't want to move your hand.
Yeah, but I can't do anything with it, so it feels like a waste.
Oh, is it an action to move and then another action to...
It sucks.
Oh. The fuck? 17 will hit. Big numbers. 9, halved is often 4. Blech. Alright, Igor. Igor needs to kill this thing.
Smashy smash, says Igor.
Smashy smash, a miss. A miss, wow. Okay, AC 15. The murder beast goes again, see if its breath weapon recharges. It does recharge. Can it move to get you, Chad? No, it'd have to move 10 feet.
Is it worth it, though?
No, not really. It is just going to fire breath Igor. So Igor, who is hurt, and this thing wants it to die, it will make a dex save of 13, failing the DC 14. Here comes the DCs. Not nearly eight. As good. 4, 8, 10, 13, 18 fire damage is suffered by Igor. And that was its entire action. Still, end this thing's career.
Alright, Eldritch Blaston.
You hit. 8. 12 is more than enough to kill it. Shattering its body with your Eldritch Blast, you destroy the spirit beast. And we are out of combat. Good job, team.
Yeah, it's the fastest combat we've done.
Half an hour.
True.
Done. Was that really half an hour? It didn't even feel like that.
Yeah, maybe 40.
It was probably less. But
like we were talking at the halfway point at 8:30 of do we want to continue with only having the three of us.
Mm-hmm. That's fair. You destroy these creatures. They are black-skinned. They don't leave a corpse behind. They turn into powder and are scattered amongst the wind. Their lion-like visages gone, replaced by an orb the size of, you know, like a fist. An adult male's fist.
Still grabs both of them.
We are definitely taking those.
You grab them.
What are those for, Sil?
We can use them later. They're good components. What, it was spirit beast orbs?
Sil, do you actually know what they are? Or are you lying your team?
No. Sil's dealt with this before. And,
is Brandon forgetting what they actually do?
Yeah, and I'm having a hard time remembering. That's why I said we'll
they regenerate the monster.
Yeah.
Okay.
There it is.
So you're lying to your teammate?
No, we can take them with us, and if we need to, we can hide them in someone's place and leave it for a surprise.
What Syl is now describing is a crime against humanity. If you do this, you will be hunted as criminals and probably ostracized by your nation. This is the ultimate crime, what he is describing to all of you.
Suppress these things so that they don't grow back, or we can not be ambushed by them in the future?
Most people know that these are breakable.
But if we put them in the enemy's town, I mean...
Chad votes for smashing.
Ivor?
I think we should smash them, because we don't want them to come back and eat our face off when we're not expecting it.
People with fucking souls, man. Alright, fine.
We have to make a roll to smash these fuckers? No. Or...
You just eat them at a tree. They shatter immediately. They're actually quite delicate. Or at least these ones are. It is an action to do so, of course, but...
I use my hand and crush it.
You crush it. You pulverize it into glass shards, which then scatter into tiny little translucent dust particles. It's a beautiful sight, Ibor. You've just destroyed a spirit beast. Your first one. Pretty good shit, huh?
It wasn't very difficult.
It wasn't, was it?
Chad's wondering what all the fuss is about.
Chad should remember.
Which spirit beast? This is the first spirit beast I think I've come across, right?
Unless you were a Toll citizen 3 years ago, in which case you can vividly remember when your city almost it was obliterated by several thousand.
I can remember that. That sucked a lot.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure Miro's fought a couple of spirits, because he did one on his own, and I think when the group was... So probably you did fight, because I told you guys about smashing them on the floor, celebrating. So I
still
think have fought them.
Still has fought a lot of them.
Hey,
I don't think,
quit
since
whining.
I've been Chad in the universe, Chad has fought any of the enemies, but...
They're the reason why I still drinks.
With victory in hand, with glass shattered, you may all continue throughout the forest, wandering. One of your familiars is dead, so get wrecked, Syl. I got one. One more.
I could do a ritual and bring it back.
Do you have the resources to do that? Do you have your incense? John knows you don't.
I have charcoal.
I don't think that is incense. I don't know why you have just random charcoal in your bag.
Hold on. Burning incense, yes I do.
What? There's no way. The audit begins now. when did you buy burning incense? Oh my god. I don't see it, boss.
It's right there, under soft clay.
Soft
total
clay.
Of five.
Is it in your fanny pack?
No, it's right there on my main thing. Where I have my counter elemental, I have all of my counters.
What? Daddy's burning incense. What the fuck?
Yeah.
I guess you actually did. Why do you have soft clay? What's water and sand for? Do you actually have spell components?
Yeah.
Oh my god, what a fucking MLG roleplayer guy. Where's your fucking spell components, guy? Oh my god, Syl. Yeah, you can do your ritual. It's not in your inventory sheet. But I guess it doesn't really have a weight.
I didn't know how much all that weighed, and it's easier for me to keep the clocker down on roll 20 with just clicking down.
It's
and
beautiful.
It just keeps things organized for me.
Do you guys want to wait 10 minutes while he ritually casts his bullshit?
Sure, why not?
Alright. 10 minutes go by, lickety split, a flash of time continues.
I'll do a comprehend languages as well.
Alright.
You got 10 minutes.
True. You have the opportunity to do it. Everyone else, Igor looks at his 8 HP. I don't think he got his lay of hands back because he was with you guys during the thingamabob.
He has the lotion, the rub.
That's gone.
Yeah, I think that was
all
used.
Of it?
I used that up. We got wrecked earlier when there was no healing.
Is there
long rest,
potions
yep.
left?
It does not appear to be.
No, I used my fun stuff.
All right,
he's at 4 hit points. My bad. Not even at 8.
Yeah, I guess I'll use healing hands on him.
How much does that heal for? This is your Azamar ability, yeah?
Yeah, it doesn't say.
And regain a number of hit points equal to your level, so it gets 10? 9?
10.
Okay, you're welcome,
nine.
Son.
Wait, what level is I? Yeah, 9. Sorry, it does say.
Okay.
I was looking for the roll shit. So
no, you're good.
He's at 13 now?
He's at 13 hit points, yes.
Alright, well, I just wasted a long rest fucking thing on him, and I got 7 out of 10.
Okay.
Yeah,
hopefully there's no more combat, right?
What's the worst that could happen?
True.
The raid team every week.
Right.
We just wanted to go shopping.
You guys go shopping in hell. You enter the forest. Time passes. Let's see if Bremir finds you. It's getting late in the day. You're kind of wandering through the woods, trying to, I guess, orbit. Well, you guys tell me, how far away from the clearing are you going to go? Because if you're in the deep wood, they can't, like, pick you guys up.
No, but we're within, you know, radio communicator distance. Right?
Okay, so you're staying within, like, a 5-mile radius?
Sure.
Okay.
I mean,
well,
that area that we were looking at, how big of a section were we talking?
I mean, that's kind of up to you, right?
I'm referring to, like, the area that wasn't getting rained on. That we originally were like, hey, we're gonna go that away.
It just ends. And now it's normal world again. It seems like the weather was destry located.
Were we trying to investigate trees or something earlier?
No, we're looking for dead space.
Do we see anything that's dead now that we're all ground level and don't have to look so hard?
Give me a nature check.
Ooh, okay.
One of the first
something
few.
I'm proficient in.
Wait, really? You're proficient in nature?
I got a check on it, yep. And I got a +4 on it. Yeah, Syl's, like, proficient in, like, weird shit.
Yeah, apparently.
And then Ebor coming out of nowhere.
Fucking Ebor with the high intelligence. You guys start investigating the trees around you, looking for any weird shit. Chad, you go up to a tree, put your head on it, try to commune with it. Of course, it doesn't talk back to you. It's a tree. But you feel your spine tingle a little, right in that weird lower quadrant of your back. Ebor, and shortly after, Bran, also known as Syl, will find something odd within one of the trees. A skeleton. A humanoid skeleton that is just sort of entwined within the roots. And although it has not moved in perhaps centuries, I mean, it's fully intact. The roots have grown around it. And it's kind of looking at you. Or in, like, your general direction. Not like its head has twisted, but it's just positioned front-facing you guys.
Does it look like it has anything shiny on it?
No. It is naked. Just bones and tree roots scattered around this 5-foot square.
I'll say hello, because I've got comprehend languages, so maybe...
If it's even alive.
You say hello.
Is it?
In your modern tongue.
I would ask Ebor to do an arc, like, check to see if anything special about, like, a magical twist to it.
Or if it's Grimir Say Grimir.
Grimir.
The wind blows heavily as you say Grimir. The shadows around you seem to darken just a little bit more.
Maybe if I say it three times, he'll appear and talk to us.
Right? Like Beetlejuice.
Go for it.
Go! Bloody Mary. Bloody Mary.
Wait, 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 hang on. Schmitty. Schmitty. Schmitty.
Eh? No. A thousand miles away, Schmitty just looks over his shoulder, swearing that he is able to hear someone calling his name.
Chad whispers on the wind, I'm gonna make you eat another fucking rat.
Jesus. Ivor, do you finish doing this weird superstitious chant that Syl wants you to do?
Mia.
You say his name three times. And although nothing immediately happens, Beetlejuice does not show up in a clown car that's being pulled by weird striped snakes. The undead creature before you seems to shift its head just a little.
I'll point at Syl.
Just point at Syl. The skeleton that is entwined within the tree just so slightly, maybe an half an inch, just turns its head so that its eye sockets instead face Syl, who's like behind you, whispering in your ear like fucking Darth Sidious.
So I guess I'll use my cantrip message.
Yeah.
And send the word speak.
Please.
It's dead. You don't have to have manners for the undead.
Sure.
You can cast a spell through solid objects. You point your finger towards a creature within range and whisper a message. The target hears the message and can reply in a whisper that only you can hear. You cast a spell through solid objects. You are familiar. Yeah. You do not get a response. At least a vocal one.
Does it make a rattle noise?
Nope.
That suggests, well, we need to get him to start talking, and we need to get him to meet Imoman. So...
After about 2 minutes of you guys, like, experimenting, trying to, like, goad the thing into talking, messaging it, and annoying it, truly, you will all hear a crunching of leaves and a shifting of trees, be it from the wind, be it from something else within the forest, but this rustling is coming all around you. What are you guys doing?
Can I try to take down the skeleton?
What do you mean, take down?
Well, you said he's, like, I'm assuming it's kind of like a cross setup to where his arms are...
He is, like, in the roots of the tree.
Oh, actually, in the roots. Oh, yeah. I thought you meant, like, okay, never mind. Well.
I'm going to make my owl disappear because I don't want it to die.
Squawk! It squawks at you like a penguin would. And then it's out of existence.
I feel like this is where that steed comes in handy.
We need to get this thing back alive or dead or whatever it is, but we need it not in a gajillion pieces. So, again, I don't think that's going to be...
I think this would have been a trigger for Igor to divine sense. And when he does so, he's going to be like, guys! In that weird scaredy cat voice that he does sometimes. And inform you all that you are surrounded by undead. Lots of undead. Like 60 feet away, hidden behind trees. As one begins to make its way towards you all.
Doesn't he have protect against good and evil?
Yeah.
Alright, well.
What else does he have in cleric land?
Not much. Igor. Igor Sheets. Where are you, Igor Sheet? Protection from evil and good, ceremony, divine favor, cure wounds, sanctuary, shield of faith, fine steed, and lesser restoration. I suppose he'll cure wounds himself then. Yep. Yep. At level 1, he heals for an additional 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. As he heals himself, is anyone readying any other actions?
I'm readying up. Spell.
What?
Wall of fire.
Okay, you do understand that if 6 seconds go by, you will lose that spell slot, correct?
No, I did not.
Okay.
I'll have the bloody thorn ready to attack anything that comes within range.
Just anything?
That is threatening us or looking like it's trying to kill us.
Yeah. Eldritch Blast set ready to go with my little peeking hands.
Everyone goes back to back as you guys say you're surrounded. Igor heals himself. Ibor, the shortest, is probably the most well protected within the formation.
I'll prepare Firebolt in case anything acts aggressively towards us.
Everyone ready spells. Everyone ready spears.
The magic cantrips.
Let us roll a 1d6. 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Syl, from your direction, whatever direction that may be, we'll just say the west for simplicity, you will see a figure standing around 6 feet tall, hidden and shrouded within a great cowl with a cape covering dark iron plate mail. This creature holds a two-handed maul in one grip casually. Close to the hammer's head so that the pole is just shooting up past his shoulder, clearly in a readied, I suppose. I mean, he's visibly presenting his weapon. I don't know if that triggers everyone's immediate reactions. Does it?
Dad would say, hang on, is that Grimir?
I was gonna say, I would probably shout Grimir.
Are you Grimir or Ibor? You can talk with him, maybe.
Well,
as you guys say this, Grimir, he raises a hand, stopping maybe 30 feet away from you all, close behind or beside a tree where undoubtedly his friends are, and he says in ancient common, Salve, which is greeted, or is a greeting that Ibor can translate to, I greet you, in a very formal way of speaking.
If Ibor, do you relay that information
it's
to us?
It's a formal greeting.
Say hi back.
Hi back.
But don't sound desperate.
You
don't
say
sound desperate?
How many talk about the punctuation that you used in this text message exchange?
Yeah.
So,
like, you know,
fun fact about comprehend languages: you get to understand them; they don't necessarily understand you. You don't get to speak their tongue. Because that is what the tongue spell is. So you can understand him, Ibor. But whether he understands you is going to be a mystery. That all being said, apparently he's communicated with modern people before, including your discovery team. So who knows? It will begin speaking at you, Ibor, who seems to, like, light up and, like, truly react to his word and then, you know, mutter. He has seen a warlock do the translating actions of comprehend languages as well. And he will speak in an ancient tongue that none of your teammates understand, as it is, like, the equivalent of a time traveler from, you know, pre-2000. Or, I guess, pre-zero, ancient Babylonian days, as it were, speaking a tongue he is fluent with that is long since been out of date. So, since one of you has comprehend languages going, I will skip any stuttered dialogue as he reaches for words, and he just assumes you can understand him. And he says, I greet you, little gnome. You understand me, correct?
I do.
Why are you... You are not, and neither is the weird one. He says, not pointing his hammer, but, like, switching his grip so its hammer head is pointed towards Syl a little bit. This one is weird, but three of you are marked with a dark magic.
Are they talking about our tattoos?
Yeah, so I'll relay that in, like, hushed whispers the group to understand. I feel like it's your face tattoos.
Why do they have the symbol? It is as though it is a beacon to us.
They got offered it?
I want to say that it looked cool.
Yeah, that's pretty much the driving force behind it.
Air pressure, and they thought it looked cool at the time.
You can let them know that it's from I'm a Man, and that we really, really would appreciate if Grimir would come and speak with I'm a Man, because, you know, Leishtan might die if they don't.
Okay, so can you come with us to talk to I'm a Man?
Because you know you are speaking the same tongue as him, correct? I can understand you all. I can't speak your language.
Yeah, that's a fair point.
When one of you speaks, you might as well just do it to my face. And this is a very weird conversational partner to all of you. I don't know how to truly describe what it is like to speak to a corpse that is moving on its own volition. Every single body motion that a normal person would make, every single, like, hand gesture, every, like, tilt of the body when it's trying to, like, convey a tone, it doesn't have that. It speaks in a monotone. It does not move its body unless it wills it to move. There is no naturalness about this at all. It is as though you are staring at a mannequin that is speaking to you as, like, an intelligent creature. It is a very alien and uncomfortable feeling as this thing addresses you and, like, tilts its head with clear thought and precision rather than, like, a natural body movement that has been built up over time. You speak of the Dark Lady, do you not? Iamon?
Iamon, same.
You hear whispers in the trees of undoubtedly other undead whisper this name.
At this point, Leishtan would probably chime in with, yeah, so I there's this dead thing that I signed, and, I mean, we would really appreciate it if you would come and talk to Iamon.
We have sealed that creature away on purpose. The fact that you are able to enter its demi-realm is a great worry.
I mean, it was just a portal. It was open.
A portal was open?
That's how we... Yes.
Did she make the portal for you?
Unclear, but she was unable to leave the portal. She needed you to come to her.
I will be blunt with you. And I'm assuming Ebor is translating all of this, and there's, like, time lag between each conversational point here that we can just sort of skip over. I will be very blunt with you. And he, like, pauses and, like, gestures towards the mall, but there's, like, no human, like, levity to it, but he's clearly going for a pun here. So maybe that doesn't translate because the Ebor, on principle, won't do the pun. But, John found it. Fine, I'll fuck off, guys. Grimir the Grave, thank you for just holding that, I guess. Grimir the Grave states bluntly, were I to enter, I would not be able to resist her commands. She was the one who freed me from my... the creature that made me this way. She has the power to act as conduit and turn us into mindless vessels of destruction. I would rather not be a slave again.
We have... Hang on.
It took me 500 years to trick her to go into that portal.
Igor, could that thing borrow your ring for a moment when we go in that portal? Would that ring be able to prevent the advances of the evil lady, Iman?
Then
on Grimir?
Technically should. Then.
What ring?
The one mind, ring to rule them all.
Mind something something ring. He's got the helmet of intellect.
To Rome, wouldn't he, though? So,
oh, yeah.
He has the mind. I don't remember the name of it. It's not my character.
I think it's mind shielding.
Yeah, it's the ring that I gave him.
Yeah.
Would that benefit our
spell? While wearing this ring, you are immune to magic that allows other creatures to read your thoughts, determine whether you are lying, know your alignment, or know your creature type. Creatures can telepathically communicate you only if you allow it. It would not work if this is what you describe to Grimir. It would come down to a saving throw that I am severely disadvantaged on passing. He mechanically explains.
If we brought you to the portal, would you be able to commune from this side?
With her? No. What is the stipulation of this bargain? For it is undoubtedly skewered to her side. Your friend may be fucked.
Ybor, you read it.
Do we have a copy of it?
Yes.
Do.
Can we just throw it to him?
Yeah, totally. You throw it to him. And he is a being of magic. He can read the magical letterings without comprehend languages. And he also has been dealing with this bitch for who knows how long. He quickly reads the contract.
We're gonna get to, yep, your buddy's fucked.
He lets out a sigh.
Just funny because it's a fucking skeleton.
Yeah. You watch him, like, animate a sigh from within himself. He must have some kind of lung system because he is speaking to you guys non-telepathically. Maybe he's got some necrotic organs still moving about in there, pushing air through his vocal cords.
Or he stole them.
Neat and gross.
Like the mummy.
He thinks for a moment. Your friend has entered a willing curse. I'm not going to lie. Iman is a clever enchanter. Chances are she wouldn't let you guys go. And honestly, judging by the marking she has on your skins, you three are probably all cursed together equally. Chances are she will dominate your minds the moment she breaks free of that portal anyway.
Oh, cool. So now we all have demons in our head.
I wouldn't call her a demon. There is a way of breaking curses. Damn it.
We have to kill her.
Well, if you could, that would help all of us, but she is practically immortal at this point. I'm further indestructible on another level of existence. There is a way of breaking this curse, but to do so would be to, or for me to bring you to the place where to break it would go against several of my own morals.
Why? Because of us or because of the place?
Because of the place. You all know of Hephaestus, yes?
Hephaestus, Hephaestus, Hephaestus.
The voice gets thrown around. Does Syl just start laughing at that, Bran?
No, it just... Because in my mind, I think of something else, and it's just, you know...
Yeah.
Odd places for things to, like, get echoed. Sorry.
No.
It was fun. I liked it.
Has the present no longer cared for the past?
I don't think I've ever come across that name.
New one for Chad.
He was an asshole beyond measure. To go into his residences undoubtedly will court your own demise. I could put you at risk for a chance of breaking this curse of yours.
Alright, let's do it.
How is it I always get stuck with... Alright.
Chad points to Igor. Look, this guy had like 17 demons in his head as of a month ago. We settled most of them, I think, probably. If not, whatever. That's future us's problem. What's another threat against our lives? That's literally our job. Yeah, let's do this.
He looks for at all of you else for confirmation.
It feels like something we're gonna be doing.
It's either that or we go murder what's-her-face. Eamon. Which sounds really, really tough.
I'm kinda down for that one, I'm not gonna lie.
All right, we need a moment, Grimir, to plan this out. What if you would allow us?
He steps away.
All right, boys. What are we doing here? We can kill Eamon, or we can go to the Forbidden Realm, the Shadow Realm, with our decks of cards looking for the magic pieces of Exodia. Leichtung's not here, but he would make a Yu-Gi-Oh reference, I'm sure.
This is true. Yeah, he does do that a little bit.
I would appreciate that joke. I appreciate that joke. What's the likelihood of if we go on a side of a side quest?
As if we go somewhere and we buy what we need instead? Because that sounds like a really good way of dealing with issues.
Chad would quickly yell to Grimir, "Hey, is there any way we could throw a metric shitload of money at this and solve this problem?"
Just throw money.
If you have a high enough level spellcaster who knows how to break a spell, yeah.
No. This is well above my fucking pay level. This is something that you have to look for a lich for, I'm assuming. But don't look at me.
Assumedly, the one who broke or is able to break this mechanic was the old Lich of Wizardry.
We told Ozark or whatever the tyrant that he's cursed, and they didn't seem like they could help.
No one has spoken to them at all about this. You guys immediately left.
Talk to them about it.
The tyrant.
We definitely talked to tyrant about the tattoos. And we talked to Tyrant about... This was right before Leichtung came back and talked about the ship artist.
Yes. Thing to remember, though, is the Tyrant is 20 years old. He probably doesn't have the best assortment of all magical curses in the world. He was also mad that Igor was about to let a bunch of fucking pirates just rampage through his court. And that was kind of his priority. And then you guys immediately left to go sleep on your airship and then go scout out the colony. So, I mean,
well, when you make it, when you say it like that, you make it seem so negative.
A second opinion is a valid option, no matter what you are doing, guys.
Oh, fuck.
Like 99% of our problems are because we don't actually think things through and we just do it. And then we all go, oh, that sounds fun, I'll join in. That's why we've got three people marked for death by the sound of it. Also, why Eagle has about 17 things in his head.
So, that makes most of us marked for death then. Nothing new. Let's go talk. Let's go back to base. Let's go back to Tulse. Let's talk to Ozark. Let's talk to Tyrant.
We don't. What's the time frame that we have left?
2 weeks.
Okay. What's the likelihood? What's the likelihood that we're gonna find this guy again?
Do you normally hang out around here? Is there a way that we can contact you?
Oh, that is to me.
Yes, Grimir, we're back.
He moves back up 30 feet away from you. I am not at liberty to discuss the movements of the Undead Legion. If you require our aid, however, find a corpse within this forest. And do not harm them.
Cool. Huh. We can do that.
Can we find out what the likelihood of, if we do this little thing for him, what the likelihood of the breaking of the curse would be?
100% if you survive.
And is it all three of them need to do this weird thing, or just Laystock? Because he was the original.
If you are marked, you are cursed. Assumedly.
Well, let's chuck it in the fuck it bucket and do that then.
Roll the Shadow Realm then?
Igor reminds everybody that he has no lay on hands and he's at 19 hit points. What's
Grimir,
an extra
would we
week?
Be able to go take a week's rest and meet you back in this forest or near wherever? We'll find a corpse and communicate with you. And then we would be able to travel with you to, or you would be able to assist us to this place to break curses.
The likelihood is high.
Long rest then, and then we'll come right back. We can hang out in Destry for a bit, or somewhere nearby. Hell, we could go back to Tulse, really.
True.
Alright, let's do that. But as long as we understand that this is what we're doing, and we're not going to delineate from this. We'll go back to Tulse, we'll come back here, and then we'll do this, because we're running kind of short on time.
I mean, in our week, we can also do a bit of recon, you know? But yes, I do find it fine to run straight back into this Shadow Realm and fuck it up.
I thought we have, like, 4 weeks left.
We should.
Yeah, but again, you're looking at transportation time, you're looking at full actual rest time.
It took you 30 hours
here.
To get here.
Yeah, we're talking like this is a day trip to get back to Tulse, right? And then it charges overnight, we take a week.
So that's 9 days.
Alright. That's still way less than 4 weeks. With plenty of fuck around on this side time. Hell, we could change our minds and then go back and fuck up Eamon if this fails. We've at least found Grimir at this point. We have ways of finding a way to communicate with Grimir. You know, we already murdered a couple Shadow Beasts. We're alright. We just need to rest up before we go and do this big thing of curse-breaking.
Are you able to give us any clues of the dangers that we would face when we're trying to break this curse?
Or anything we could potentially go on a shopping spree to prep ourselves for?
I'm no wizard.
I mean, is it going to be like creatures of the night that are going to try and ravage us, or water's going to suffocate us, or...
John thinks for a moment. Hephaestus was an asshole. of the highest degree. If you trigger one of his traps, it will instantly kill you. Most of the time.
Okay, so it's going to be magical traps, probably, that's going to be the issue.
That is what we had to deal with getting in. However, we were never truly able to kill the beast that lurks within inside. There may be a monster or two. We will assist you in that.
Awesome, thanks.
It is our duty.
Yeah, you said duty.
Chad also chuckles at the translation via Igor.
You should leave before the night comes. The spirit beasts that stalk you even now tend to come out at night. And this place is more arcane enriched.
Thank you for all of your help. We'll be back soon.
The undead does not nod or bow or do any sort of dismissing or, you know, goodbye, I suppose. He watches you leave, and after you guys get about 90 feet away, he is obscured by the forest. The creatures that you heard echoing throughout the woods are nowhere to be found. But you all feel like you are being watched as you quickly head back to where your airship is, having them throw on like a searchlight just so you can sort of see them in the dusk sky and orient yourselves towards them a little bit easier.
Not gonna lie, he was really cool, guys.
Pretty nice for a skeleton delegate.
Not saying I want him to have my babies, but you know.
I'm not saying no either.
Something, something, boner.
Bloosh.
If only Grimir had a cock. Okay.
I guess you could say he has a boner too.
On your way back!
I laughed at your joke, John.
It was funny. I just rolled your nightly encounter and rolled a 100.
God damn it.
Oh, we're going to get marked by another spirit beast or something. Hooray.
No. You guys find, on your way back, where you swear you had traveled before, a small clearing, a copse of trees on your way back. There is a cabin before you. It has a porch with a light on. There is a sign that says open. And above the top of the door, it says General Good Store.
Sprinting, Chad goes straight to the fucking
cabin. We will see who beats anyone next time on City States of Clovisa as you guys run into my deep, dark, scary woods. We will be rolling for initiative and set you guys on a foot race for those who know what this is.
Oh boy.
Guys, thank you so much for joining us. As always, please, you know, do whatever you want to do, I guess, in life. But on Thursday, we'll be seeing the Discovery Team with John/Val's new character, which he has, I guess, made. He sent me his little dope Word document, so I can't wait to see how he's going to play as that. What he sent me, no spoilers. Then on Saturday, since I don't think anyone we care about or know is playing at Greg's stream this Friday. I don't think anyone is. I could be wrong, though, and if I am, I will adjust that for Thursday. On Saturday, we have the continuation of a political team who will be running into something dangerous on the way back from their fact-finding infiltration mission of Destry as well. Lots of stuff happening in Destry, guys, not gonna lie. And then on Sunday, the same week, we will be doing our second mass combat test Which last week we had Rumble Roar slash Chad playing with us. So if anyone's
we died,
interested,
and then we didn't die. It was great.
It was some game testing right there. Mr. Underground was in it as well. Shout out to Mr. Underground indeed, and of course Alden Horseboy joined us for that as well. So if you are interested in playtesting a tabletop war game based off 5th edition Dungeons and Dragons, hit us up. Or hit me up specifically in our Discord down below. Any shout outs from you guys you want to do?
I'm going to throw some, where is this? Some malware on the screen.
Okay.
From my boy Devin, who could not malware it up today.
True.
I got a shout out.
Yeah.
Thank you, Satan, for everything you do. My man.
Punishing the sinners. Praise him. this is a Satanist friendly stream now, guys. I guess if that's all, we will see you guys next Monday. Thank you so much. Hopefully CK will be back by then. And you know, good luck to Devin in Las Vegas. We know what's at stake.
Devin, bet on black.
Don't do it.
Always on black.
All right. We'll be seeing you guys next time. Blah, blah, blah. We're out.